In this edition of Art Loft, a painter takes cues from some of history's great artists.
Story comes through on their face, and when it's real, it ends up always being better.
And another from nature's majestic sea life.
Some real study work on the actual fish itself, and put a little bit of an artistic twist on it, put all the elements of art that I like and put it into the marine life.
How about using modern technology to connect people with centuries-old artwork?
What we're trying to do with this technology is put the visitor front and center.
And a lone skater emits emotional energy. It's all ahead on this edition of Art Loft.
Funding for Art Loft was made possible by the John S. and James L. Knight Foundation, Newman's Own, giving all profit to charity and pursuing the common good for over 30 years, Alva H. and Wyline P. Chapman Foundation, and
in the Florida Keys and Key West, every night is a spectacular show. And every day is another masterpiece.
Hi, I'm Kalyn James, and from Canvas Gallery, this is Art Loft. Inspired by master painters such as Rembrandt and Caravaggio, Luke Hillestad creates haunting pieces of art that capture a strong sense of emotion. For Art Loft, Hillestad takes us into his studio for a painting session with one of his models.
I want to include the story that I initially had for the painting, but also collaborate with my model. Because their story comes through on their face, and when it's real, it ends up always being better. I don't go for photorealism. There's a bit of an extra real thing that I'm trying to achieve. I studied music at the U of M and got a degree in classical guitar and music composition, and took a few drawing classes in school. But it wasn't until after college and after I quit a job land surveying that I decided to become a painter. When I first started painting, I thought it'd be fun to do a bunch of paintings of my friends in hoodies and jeans. And then I tried to experiment to see what it would take to make things that look like they could be from any century, whether it's the past or the future. I like painting with live models. I like to get close with the models and learn about their story if I don't already know it.
Can you feel the heat? Is that too hot?
It should be fine.
Okay. Kalyn Krolzek and I have known each other for a while.
I'm fine with being sort of uncomfortable for a while. It's okay. Not a huge deal, yeah. So whatever looks best.
Great. We're Facebook friends, so I see good photos of her, so I already picked out a good angle.
Look like up here. Yeah, and then drop your chin quite a bit. And you can like stick it up. Yeah, that's awesome.
I'm dividing the canvas into eight. It's just a guide, I guess. And then there's often compositional points when you divide it into eight. So if you put a lot of weight on the three here or on the five there, that's something Rembrandt did a lot and something I try to model after. Mostly I try to go from nature. So whatever Kalyn's doing, I'll try to capture what's most special about that. I like painting from life for a sense of conversation. Sort of lean into it. You're kind of like, it's like...
Like I'm Golem, like...
Yeah, well, yeah. I like the energy where it feels like a sense of urgency with the paint. Nice, that's it. If you can, that's the pose, if you can remember it. The shot that you got in the photo is this quick action shot.
Yeah.
So it's gonna be hard to keep. But sort of the nature of painting, I guess.
My nose itches.
You look worried in the painting so far. That's not how you look right now.
Huh?
Something's going wrong.
I look worried in the painting?
So far. But it doesn't have to do with how you look. It just has to do with how the paint happened to move real quick. I use a limited palette rather than any sort of other palette. I like to keep the colors as cohesive as possible, create some sort of harmony within the colors. And I like painting with a rough surface or with a lot of history, so you can tell that it's been worked through. Maybe I've changed my mind a lot with how the painting's going, just because that's how it goes. So I don't necessarily pre-plan everything that's going to happen in a painting. I'll let it rest for times. I'll let it dry in different layers. And you're doing really well. I'm actually a bit surprised how well you're holding this. The model might be there for a couple hours, and I might change my mind multiple times within that time. And the relaxed atmosphere, the slow atmosphere, gives me time to, I think, make better choices.
Oh, my butt's numb.
My teacher in Norway, when I modeled for him, showed me the importance of it when he might ask me to move my hand a little bit, and I realized that he was in the process of composing as he painted. I had the opportunity to study with Odd Nerdrum in 2008. To go study with Nerdrum, I sent him a letter, sent him some pictures of my work, and asked him if I could. And then I got a letter a number of months later saying, "You're welcome to come, here's our address." It was an invitation, and so I bought a plane ticket and flew out there. It was a pretty intensive time of learning, just watching him and absorbing things. He didn't talk much about technique. It mostly just came through apprenticeship style observing. I decided to study with Odd Nerdrum again for the second time, and I'll be going to Paris to stay for about 4 months. It's going to be a new city, so I'm hoping to paint outside more, get some sunshine instead of being cramped up in an attic. He's a big inspiration as far as what's possible. He's been painting for 45 years or so, and there's a lot of what he does that I hope to emulate, while also going deeper into my own psyche or whatever, and find out what I'm supposed to be painting.
You're gonna make me look like a goth chick.
Oh, moon so low in the sky, it taps its feet around my bedside, and it breaks the locks on all my dreams. Who hung the moon with its twisted beam?
I think Luke's work is great. The light in his work is really amazing. Just the darkness and then the brightness, and that's something that's hard for a lot of painters to learn. So Luke is doing, you know, themes and stories, and I mean, there's not a lot of figural artists around, especially in the Twin Cities area. I look angry, though.
Well, not angry.
Just making me relax.
Not angry, just a little worried. It might have to do with the pose. Any overarching themes for me in painting probably center around being earnest. Try to avoid irony. Irony is good for jokes with people, but irony doesn't last in painting for me. And glowing flesh and transparent spirit. I like to paint people because I like people. I like people around my studio. I like mimesis. I like being able to reproduce something I see. And the feeling I get for making it look similar and having a similar essence is really satisfying for me.
To see more of Luke Hillestad's paintings, visit lukehillestad.com. Roberto Pantaleo goes by the name of Pasta, but this Italian-American painter is all about marine life. Combining traditional techniques with an abstract twist, Pasta's art captures the spirit and energy of his favorite subject, game fish. We traveled to Isla Morada and caught up with the artist at his studio. Take a look.
Fortunate to be able to look at a blank canvas and see a finished product. My inspiration is I'll take what's real with some real study work on the actual fish itself and put a little bit of an artistic twist on it, put all the elements of art that I like and put it into the marine life. We're all from Italy, and I watched my dad paint and draw, and I started focusing on sea life as a young kid. The warm weather, the south called, a few of my brother came first down here, Nick. Got my nickname from him. He was the original Pasta Fazul, because he had a heavier accent than I did, and they called me Pasta Junior when I was a kid. I do performance art mostly for fundraising efforts, and I will start painting while people are doing their fundraising efforts and the dinners, and by the time the dinner's done and the auction starts, I'm signing it, and we usually live auction that piece, and I'll give the brush I signed it with right then and there to the people, and the paint's still wet. This is called Keys to Life. My first gallery was named after this painting. It's one of my more successful paintings, and it has no fish in it, so it's kind of like ironic to me because I was known as a game fish artist my entire career. And the one piece I painted that I wanted just a real palette of the mangroves and kind of a surreal look to it, and kind of pulled all the fishing parts of my world out of it. And it's been my most successful painting in so many ways. People put it over their couches, over their beds. I love pop art and I like fish. Game fish is my specialty. So I wanted to bring the pop art world and my fishing community together. The Golden Boy, this one's the Dorado. I named it Golden Boy because Dorado is gold and it's a male dolphin. The shape of the head dictates it's a male dolphin and it's a bull dolphin. So I named this piece Golden Boy. It's been pretty successful. The espresso up here, this was the original espresso. It's a black marlin and it was coined espresso because the word espresso is rapid in Italian and it's done in coffee type colors. And this was the very first one. In 07, it debuted at the boat show, and there was a line looking at it and taking pictures of it because I've never done one before and people hadn't seen a monochromatic marlin. Each room has a little different of a vibe, and we're in the espresso room, which is a little bit more old world. I got an antique a counter desk here, and it's kind of got that old Cuban Key West look, and the other rooms have a different colored palette, and it shows the clients too what they can do with their art. The warmth and the vibe here has been so great. It's been the best gallery I've ever had. I mean, I just love this place.
If you'd like to learn more about Pasta, no, not the kind you eat, silly, the artist, visit his studios or go to his website, artbypasta.com, or you can log on to fla-keys.com.
So here, this wonderful portrait of Nathaniel Hurd is an American painting. And if you go through this cover flow, you can find other American paintings in our collection.
We continue our series of films from the Optic Never Film Festival, held each year by the Museum of Contemporary Art in North Miami. This week, Mocha presents a film by the TM Sisters, artists previously profiled on Art Loft. The TM Sisters view art as a process for engagement, and that concept is reflected in their film. She said, as long as you run with me. Watch as emotions, colors, and energies intersect. This year's Optic Nerve will be held on August 23rd, and the call to artists is already open. If you're interested in submitting a film or just getting more information, visit their website at mochanomi.org.
I'm working on a handmade paper piece. It's kind of about the veiled woman. I call it Beauty and the Beast. This figure, kind of a beast-like, and this is a woman with a veil with her eye exposed.
Visiting an art museum can sometimes be intimidating or even perplexing. Trying to put the art and artist in context can be a challenge, but there's an app for that. The Cleveland Museum of Art recently began offering visitors iPads loaded with software called Art Lens, which works with a set of large video screens called a collection wall to put information about the artworks right at your fingertips.
One of the things that museums do with works of art when they hang them on the wall or they put them on a pedestal, sometimes they're taken out of their original context. And what the Art Lens iPad app can do is restore some of that context. And so you can use the iPad to scan works of art, and the iPad in camera mode will recognize those works and hotspots will pop up immediately and you'll find out some chunks of information. If you want to delve more deeply, there are two other ways in which you can do that. You can take an organized tour on the iPad app, and you can take a tour of Gallery 1, or you can go into the main collection galleries and take a tour that will allow you to go through and find works of art that you like. There's another section that is more for browsers, and that's called Near You Now. And it uses the GPS system in the iPad to navigate you through the galleries. And you can find works of art that you like and see if they are interpreted in the iPad app. And you can connect with video, with audio. Many voices from the museum and also from the community can round out your experience of these works of art in amazing ways. The iPad can be docked at our collection wall, which is a wonderful, cutting-edge, one-of-a-kind, 40-foot multi-touch screen that shows all of the works in our collection that are on view, plus some others. You can dock the iPad at the collection wall. You can begin to interact with the wall and browse through and find works of art that you really like. You can save them to the iPad and then begin to create a list of favorites or even create your own tour. And then you can go into the galleries based on your interests. What we're trying to do with this technology is put the visitor front and center to allow them to create their own pathways through our collection to have a really meaningful experience. We don't want to dictate to them what they can do. They can come here and create their own experience and really enjoy themselves here. So in this view, you can see all of the works in our collection that are on view in our permanent galleries right now, plus some works that are not on view. And we love this wall because it gives you a sense that the collection is always in motion. It is always changing right before your eyes, depending on how you look at it, depending upon the perspective that you have. And you can see it as a living organism rather than something that's stagnant and remote. So if you go up to the wall, you can select a work of art. You can find out that it actually is related to a number of other works in our collection according to categories. So here, this wonderful portrait of Nathaniel Hurd is an American painting. And if you go through this cover flow, you can find other American paintings in our collection and begin to see, sort of set that wonderful portrait in context. But you can also find out, here is an American painting from the 1940s. Well, let me select the 1940s and see other works of art from the 1940s in our collection. This takes you across geography to see what were artists doing across the world in 1940. So it's a wonderful tool. If you come to a work of art, let's say this work, and you really love it, you can use your iPad and you can dock it here at the collection wall. And you can save the artwork to your iPad.
It's almost like a self-guided tour. You know, instead of having to wait for a particular tour to start, you can pick your favorite pieces of artwork and learn as much as you want to at your own pace, which is really nice.
Because I wanted to get closer to the artwork, you can always read the little tag cards next to the work, and it just gives you a little bit, but here I just found out with this piece, I can actually see some video of how this piece was actually created, which gives me another layer of learning about the artwork. It does free you up. It makes you feel a little more to be connected with the work, but also feel the space of what information they're trying to give to you. There's a lot of information, but it's so freeing that it's not piled on you all at once, and so you can memorize a lot more of the information as well and take it home with you.
Many times people feel like works of art are inaccessible, that they're in a case, that somehow they're even dead. And we need tools to help people feel like these works are actually alive and that visitors in their exchange with works of art have something to say to actually change the life of a work of art, to make it relevant in their lives. So a technology can be a great tool in bridging that gap between antiquity and 2013. But we found that visitors said, sort of in the aggregate, two things. They wanted a personal presence in the gallery. They really wanted somebody they could come up to and talk to, ask questions of. But they also wanted a technology piece, something that would allow them, sort of on their own time, to be able to fill in the gaps and understand works of art more, so that either they might feel less intimidated by the works of art on view, or if they're a seasoned visitor, it just allows them to find more and more information.
Yes, it's amazing. Like, the sculpture around the corner is from like year one. I mean, it's like 2,000 years old, but it just shows the power of art and that there's different ways of enjoying it.
So our peers in the field say all eyes are on Cleveland because we're using technology in a new way. We are creating this wonderful collection wall that you see behind us using a very large 40-foot microtile screen. This is the largest that we know of. But we're using technology in interesting combinations so that you can dock your iPad at the collection wall, use them in tandem as a big tool that then can sort of vault you into the permanent collection with a lot of information under your belt and a lot of fun.
The ArtLens app is the first of its kind in the country, and museums from coast to coast are waiting to see how the grand experiment works out. You can download ArtLens to your own iPad from clevelandart.org. And speaking of websites, be sure to visit wpbt2.org for more information on this program, or you can follow us on Facebook and Twitter at ArtLoftSFL. Well, thanks for joining us. That's all for this week, and for ArtLoft, I'm Kalyn James, reminding you, stay creative. See you next week. Hi, I'm Kalyn James, and from Canvas Gallery, this is the microwave. Hi, I'm Kalyn James, and from Canvas Gallery, this is Art Loft. Okay, here we go, take 18. Kalyn James, and from, sorry, too loud.
Funding for Art Loft was made possible by the John S. and James L. Knight Foundation, Newman's Own, giving all profit to charity and pursuing the common good for over 30 years, Alva H. and Wyline P. Chapman Foundation, and
in the Florida Keys and Key West, every night is a spectacular show. And every day is another masterpiece.